So over the weekend, I watched Woodstock, the director's cut, again on TCM on Sunday night. Maybe some of you watched it too. But every now and then, every so many years, I like to revisit that film. And people think that, oh, Fran, did you go to Woodstock? It's like, how old do you think I am? No, I mean, Woodstock is about my parents' generation. And even though people like to try to flatten me out by calling me a boomer, I'm not a boomer. I'm solid Gen X. The thing about Woodstock is that it shows young people in a world that doesn't exist anymore. Organic young people. No phones, no televisions. Just living in the now, living in the present, watching a show in the present, dealing with all of the turmoil and problems in the present. But present. It isn't that the kids in the Woodstock film are wiser than kids today, or more worldly, or more responsible, but they were very different. The last generation to be unadulterated by modern technology, probably. Even though they were all like in the modern times, it was before junk food and fast food restaurants and social media and the internet and mobile phones. And people had to relate with each other face to face, as they did with the townspeople. And the townspeople were initially petrified of all these kids coming in to like wreak havoc, like all the movies were saying that they would. And then day 2, 3, 4, the people of Woodstock, the older people of Woodstock, they had nothing but good things to say about their invading children, about how polite they were and courteous, and how they weren't causing any trouble, and how they were helping people out, and how they, you know, changed some minds. But it's very much in contrast to the experience that I had only this past week when I was walking down one of the streets here, Cow Hill. It's a little narrow street where there's this one block where the restaurants are. And so a lot of people tend to congregate there waiting to get into restaurants, especially in the morning when I take my walk. And I'm walking, and the sidewalk is narrow. You know, it's like you got stairs for the houses on one side, and you got trees and cars on the other, and you got like room for two people to walk on the sidewalk. And I'm walking one way, and I come up against this young couple, 20-something, you know, slightly bearded guy, and very, prim and proper young lady, and they've got their dog, and they're playing on the sidewalk. The guy's got his leash holding the dog, the dog is flopping around on the sidewalk, and the woman is down on the sidewalk with the dog, petting the dog and everything, and the three of them are taking up the whole sidewalk, stairs to tree. So I come up to them, and they don't recognize that I'm there, even though I'm standing right there, and I said, "Excuse me, I'd like to get by," and they ignore me. And I say, "Excuse me, I just want to get around you, please," and they ignore me. And so I squeeze myself between the tree and the woman, which then gets their attention, and she gets up, and they stare at me and look at me shockedly, and I said, "Well, you know, thanks for recognizing that there are other people around you," to which the young man says to me, "Thanks for letting us know that you're such a bitch." And they both laugh hysterically. It's like, yes, that's me. I'm a bitch for asking politely twice for you to let me pass, and you refusing. And yes, so I was like, yes, this is the generational divide between 20-somethings and 50-somethings today. I wonder how many times that young man has called his own mother a bitch to her face. And why is it so amusing to say that to me? For calling out their disrespect. I don't care that they respect their elders. I'm another human being, and they took over the whole sidewalk to enjoy their dog, and I busted their cool because I needed to go somewhere. that it's just the importance, the self-importance, self-righteousness, the complete lack of courtesy. All the young people I run into, there's no please, thank you, excuse me, pardon me. It's just barge in, get in front of you, you know, just invade your space, you know, push through. I'm doing this, you're in the way, boom. No communication, no talking. They don't talk to people at all. It's just push through, ignore, push through, ignore, ignore, ignore. What kind of a world are these young people gonna make? Yeah, you know? Now, obviously, like, the kids of the Woodstock generation, they grew up to be the adults of the 80s who, you know, made the 80s, you know, the discovered money and social climbing and wealth and all that, you know, they got corrupted. But I do wonder what kind of a world will become in future decades, when, because courtesy, politeness, you know, decency, being decent to other people who are around you, having a sense of social space, the idea that the world is not actually your living room couch, that when you're out amongst strangers that you should behave differently than you do when you're sitting on the toilet, that there are different kinds of behaviors for being in society and being by yourself, that these things don't exist anymore. They dissolved away. And now everybody just behaves at their worst all the time. There isn't even the pretense of being courteous, because being courteous is for losers, and politeness is so gay. And from my whiny, aged position, civilization only functions if people are courteous and have manners. When, as a society, you decide that manners are stupid, that courtesy is a waste of energy, that communication is for suckers, civilization just simply ceases to exist. And I'm seeing that in younger people. And it worries me. It worries me a lot. That's not to say that people of past generations were better. They certainly had their issues. But society, for all the flaws and all the problems, all the societal problems of past decades, the ability of people to navigate through those problems and the way that people related to each other, even in the most difficult of circumstances, was much different than it is today. Today, everything's at the highest possible volume. Conversation, dialogue, argument, debate, these are all very quaint 20th century relics that they're just not present anymore. And, you know, my making this speech, it's like, yes, it's get off my lawn. I would have gotten away with it too if it weren't for you meddling kids. The kids these days, but I mean, I'm not the cranky old lady who sits on the lawn. I mean, I listen to college radio all day. I go to live shows of young bands. I'm an audience to young culture. I listen to it. I read their opinions. I read the books of young authors. It's not like I'm out of touch. What is different is that in every generation of human beings up until like the last 10 years, maybe in the 60s that there was this counterculture metaphor of don't trust anyone over 30. Well, that might have been a slogan, but people back then, they didn't think that their elders were stupid, ignorant people that they could never learn from. And when I was young, when I was in my 20s, I always sought out people who were much, much older. One of my best friends was Mr. Morris, who was a World War II veteran who had a television repair shop. And I used to go over to his shop and just chew the fat and listen to him tell his stories and go through his museum of radios and televisions. And he was just this wellspring of life experience. You know, he was a photographer in World War II, and his job was documenting the frontline battles and stuff. So, I mean, he was shooting film right where the action was all the time. So, I mean, like he saw it all. And he was just this very calm and like had this way of spinning a yarn. And I valued his time And when I would go to his shop, I'd always be there for like 3 hours. He would get no work done. And I just cherished that. And but now, the focus on youth culture is to the point where it's youth is fetishized to the point where not having youth is considered a disease. That, you know, when you're to not have youth, it's like losing all your hemoglobin. Like, it, case in point about the fear of just how terrible and unfortunate and sad it is to be old. Like, the worst thing that could happen to a person is to get old. So they made a horror movie about it called Old, where the whole source of the horror is that these kids get old. And how unspeakable it is. They got old, oh my god, they get wrinkled, oh my god, and they die from being old. Ah, it's worse than vivisection. The ultimate horror. And, you know, what social media has given us is apps to make even young people look younger, because even young people have too many wrinkles, so they run apps to like take the wrinkles out of you, because you're 25 and your skin looks too old. So you make a cartoon of yourself? Yes. I'm 56 years old. I it's not like I'm 85, but to someone who's 20-something, the difference between like me and Biden, it's like, oh, it's like there's no difference. It's back to anyone over 30 is just, they're in the crypt, you know, they're the walking dead. The stench of death is upon you because you've crossed that plane of 30. It's like, Logan's Run is not a documentary, I'm sorry. And again, I'm not going to ever say how great my generation is, because that's just not true. I'm certainly not going to say about how great the 20th century was, because it was a fucked up time. But that doesn't make now great. And the disintegration of people who refuse to communicate with other people, who have no attention span, who cannot carry on a conversation and would not ever want to, who do not read and would not ever want to, who do not ask or use courtesy or politeness just because other people are an inconvenience to them, not to be asked to or requested from, but to be ignored, were pushed through and bulldozed over like a weed on a hike. That's my unfortunate experience. I'm not just gonna say that that represents everyone in the younger generations. I'm not gonna say that there's no one who doesn't have a moral compass or a sense of society or a long attention span or reads, but we're talking a very small minority who might qualify for that, in my experience. And what's even added to that is that even those of my generation are throwing off all the things that they were raised with, like courtesy and attention span and stuff like that, because even people in my generation, they're getting addicted to their phones and become walking, texting zombies, who literally walk into light poles and fall into their face on the street because they're living in their phone and not in the world around them. Hello. Even people of my generation are sloughing off courtesy and things like that and becoming grumbly, mean, upset, inconvenienced. Everything in the world is an inconvenience and an obstruction, and everyone in it is an inconvenience and an obstruction. And nowadays, everyone's lost all patience, so they only want to be exposed to things that make them feel good, and anything that makes them feel uncomfortable or challenges their beliefs or is contrary to their set of values or what they think is dangerous, and it's just la la la. Shut it down. Destroy it. We used to have conversations. We used to have argument. Our argument doesn't mean shouting at each other. Argument means you give a point of view, you stop, I give a point of view, I listen to you, I retort, you listen to me, you counter me, and you say, I hear what you're saying about that, but this is what I think about this. And I say, well, you might say that, but what you don't realize is this, and you try to win on the merits. Argument is not all-out thermonuclear war. Argument is I listen to you, I retort, I disagree with you because this. It's not shouting at each other. There used to be rules to argument, I guess. They used to teach classes about debate, about how to debate. And of course, the stereotypes of people my generation not knowing anything about technology, not being able to do this or that and the other thing, it's like, well, it's probably true of my mother's generation. Again, I'm not a baby boomer. I grew up the time of home computing, and I was early on the internet. You don't understand the internet. It's like, I've freaking been on the internet since 1994. You know, I have one of the oldest domains on the internet. One of the oldest domains, one of the first. But yet, it's just easy to say that I just don't understand. I just don't get it. Oh, I get it. I disagree with you because I have perspective and years behind me, and I've seen the world without the internet. I've seen the world with the internet. I've seen the world a lot of different ways. And I do not like the present. I do not like the present. The problem is, too, I can't even say, well, you know, you young person who called me a bitch for calling you out on your lack of courtesy, I can't retort, oh, when you get to my age, you'll understand, because that kid who thinks that I'm a bitch, they're not gonna have perspective when they get to my age. When they get to my age, they're gonna be a friggin' mess, a nightmare. They're gonna be so disgruntled, so bent out of shape, so, like, inconsolably angry at everything. This is the thing. These younger kids with absolutely no tolerance for pain, absolutely no tolerance for inconvenience, absolutely no tolerance for anything outside of their very specific narrow ethos. Age is going to make them crazy. As time passes, they're not going to mellow. They're going to literally, like, lose all ability to cope. Like, not even, like, in their 30s, 40s. By the time they get to, like, half my age, they're going to be falling apart. Life is going to bulldoze over them because they have no strengths. They are so fragile. So fragile. Life is a steamroller, and when you are pampered and padded and insulated, I mean, I grew up as an autistic kid in a time when those kinds of things weren't recognized, and I had a terrifying childhood because I was overloaded all the time, and there were no soft spots. There was no comfort. I you know, when I got into my adult years, I had built up so many calluses to so much. But honestly, the world is such a harsh place. Without all those calluses, without all that abuse that I took, I wouldn't have had the strength to bolster myself, to do anything with my life, to fight bullies, to fight people who were gonna do me harm, to protect myself, defend myself, to build a life in a world where everybody was out to get me in some way. Those kinds of strengths, I look at the younger people and it's like, for young people, strength is in numbers. They walk around with their phone like somehow it's like a suit of armor, like their phone is protecting them. Like, I've watched young women walking around at night with a phone, they're holding the phone as if it's like a totem. Like, I have my phone, nothing can happen to me. It's like, the phone does not stop the reality of the world from getting to you. Put down your phone, look around you, look for the real dangers, look for the people that are potentially dangerous to you. Watch for the cars that are gonna try to run you over. Again, I'm not gonna tell people what to do. I'm not gonna tell people how to live. I'm just sad. I'm sad that people are not literate, that people don't care about education, real education, like reading about things that are very hard to read. And I don't mean hard to read because the language is hard, I mean hard to read because the subject is very uncomfortable. Like reading the news because the news is terrible, and the things that are going on in the world and the struggles that people have and the conflicts and the politics of the world is so disheartening and so troublesome. So people don't want to know history. People don't want to know news. And so they're so easily manipulated and so easily lied to and so easily driven into rage and to becoming part of a mob driven by hysteria and lies. That's the future. More mobs, more outrage, less conversation. We're not going to discuss things. We're just going to go at each other, knives out. Ugh. Old cranky bitch talking about boomer stuff. Dislike, thumbs down.
At the bench again.